please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
Same things might keep performing.
Okay, actually at the moment, market's opening with a fair degree of bullishness. It started 0.4 up, now it is 0.3 up. So a little bit of selling has come at the highest point, but it has stopped at 0.3. So let me take that. 11,717, 715 is about, say, the opening tick now. And 0.4 up still on the Sensex, that's 160 up. The Bank Nifty is the weakest performer and it's actually losing strength a little faster than the bigger index. So now it's up just 0.1, 24 points higher. Wipro is your best performer with a 5 to 6% gain. Aisha Motors is responded well to the numbers, not really bothered too much by the tractor sales. Tata Motors, Sun Pharma, actually all the rupee stocks, Sun Pharma, Cipla, all of them doing well. HPCL surprisingly is doing well. It has a double whammy, doesn't it? But looks like the government will allow it to price out everything. So HPCL looks undeterred. DRL again high. So all the drug stocks, pharma stocks doing well. At the moment, Indiabulls Housing also is in the green. In the red, ICICI Bank, after all those SFIO investigation into those Videocon and related Kochar Group companies, you never know what muck it might throw up, probably is what investors are worried about. And anyway, the stock has risen a goodish bit. Otherwise, Bajaj Finance, all of them are seeing a bit of profit-taking. Axis Bank, all the ones that have risen so far have seen profit-taking, and now the Nifty Bank is in the red.
Okay, the Nifty Bank is in the red. The mid-cap index is holding up almost 0.3%. The market breadth is good, almost 1,000 stocks on the advancing side. But the pocket that's getting hit really hard this morning are all the construction and real estate companies because of that ban in three states. DLF, Godrej Properties, Indiabulls Real Estate, Oberoi Realty, Suntech, all of the Maharashtra-based companies, Mumbai-based companies are getting hit down about 2 to 3 odd percent. Of course, DLF is also because of that case on the land deal, the FIR filed against Robert Vadra. So DLF is down almost about 2.5% over there. L&T Infotech is also under pressure. We spoke about that earlier in the day. On the upside, Ashok Leyland is really the stock of the moment. Almost a 4% up move on Ashok Leyland after a second consecutive month of very strong commercial vehicle sales. You have Wipro that we spoke about as well on that acquisition that they made and the fresh deal that the acquired company has won. So Wipro is up almost about 6.5%. In fact, the entire IT space is looking pretty good. So you have Mindtree that's moving up. A couple of these companies actually sitting at fresh highs as well. So IT, I guess, continues to be the flavor of the moment. Idea Cellular is moving up with quite a bit of strength too. The last few days have been good for telecom, so looking good there. And just a couple of more stocks on the gaining side. You have TVS Motor that is up almost about 1 odd percent. 8% sales growth is what TVS Motor has seen this month. And yes, it's IT, pharma and a couple of auto companies that are looking good. Otherwise, it's just about consolidating around this 11,700.
You know, on expected lines, Sonia, we discussed this. We'll have a gap up which will take us close to all-time high and perhaps risk-reward-wise, you'll have fresh selling over there. The Bank Nifty is already down 50 points. Ambuja Cement is down quite a bit. That's, of course, the Maharashtra, you know, the companies which are most exposed to Maharashtra and Mumbai. These are the companies where you will see all kind of construction, real estate companies where at least till the time uncertainty is there, there will be some selling pressure. And of course, Ashok Leyland on the way up really stands out. Ashwani, your thoughts on market opening? The first bar on both Nifty and Bank Nifty is rather big on the red side actually.
See, that's what happens when you have these large premiums and you know some kind of adverse news comes in. I think financials will not have a good day. Prima facie, so get short on the financials. I would expect you know, Bank Nifty and Nifty to lose some of this premium because I don't think you know, upside is going to be sustainable immediately today. Plus, given global cues, etc., etc., I think it's a good time to get short, particularly on financials. There is you know, some sort of this macro tailwind that's happening, and I think long positions will get into trouble by the end of the day. Initially, what you want to sell is, you know, get short on some of these, you know, banks, etc., which could move lower.
Okay, well, ICICI Bank is the one that is topping the charts on the losing side. It's down almost about 1.5%. And Reliance is also dragging the markets a bit. Now the Nifty is just about getting into the red, absolutely flat. for the moment. So Darshan, your initial thoughts on the market? A lot of large caps are under pressure now.
Well, yes, that was what we hoped, that there would be a minor dip on the downside. And I would still be a buyer in the Nifty, somewhere around 11,710 for the futures, that is Nifty futures. A dip towards that area would give me a buying opportunity with a stop at 11,650. So I'm assuming this is a dip in an ongoing uptrend.
Yeah, but Prakash, your thoughts?
I think I like two stocks here, Ashok Leyland and Eicher Motors. We could see an upside here, but the banks like ICICI Bank is looking weak to me. It's more into a consolidation mode now. We could see some dip in the banks.
Okay, and Ashwani, what's your big call for the day then?
See, get short on financials is 180, 200 points is, you know, silly premium. This will get taken out. So target could be, you know, 27, 950, 970, which is basically the lows of the day before. But definitely, there has been selling at higher levels. There is a 100-point bar on the first 5 minutes on Bank Nifty. So definitely, more downside is coming.
Okay. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for joining us with your thoughts. Uden, I wanted you to stay on for just a bit. What do you make of Yes Bank now?
I don't know where this thing will head, Lata, frankly, because so far Rana Kapoor has been allowed to continue. Whether there will be a change or whether he will continue going forward, we'll have to see. But the reaction was quite sharp on Friday in the stock price in any case. So we'll just have to see. I mean, I'm presuming that is the only news that is swirling around Yes Bank, unless there has been some other news which I'm not aware of. But I think the market is basically thinking a lot about what is going to be the management picture for many of these private banks 1 year out. I mean, all of them, HDFC Bank, ICICI Bank, Axis Bank, Yes Bank, I mean, they could have IndusInd Bank, they could all have new managers. And the past crop of managers have been so instrumental in creating enormous amount of wealth. A little bit of a stutter is quite understandable. But, you know, sometimes the change is for the better. So we'll see how this pans out.
Okay. What about the move that we're seeing in the commercial vehicle space, Udayan? I mean, it's been a couple of months now of very good numbers coming in. Ashok Leyland once again is making an attempt to get back to its all-time highs. You think this is a space that could continue to see more traction?
It could. And, you know, on hindsight, Sonia, Ashok Leyland gave you a very good buying opportunity when it dipped to close to 100 rupee levels because of all the tonnage concerns which came about. Now, they seem to have reduced a bit and the stock has bounced back, of course, aided by the monthly numbers, which have been very good. Let's see how the interplay of market share between Ashok Leyland and Tata Motors also plays out. But if you have to play commercial vehicles, I guess you have no option but to go with Ashok Leyland, because for Tata Motors, the bigger consideration, of course, is JLR, which sometimes surprises on the negative, or mostly these days, and sometimes pulls out a good number. So that's becoming very difficult to predict, the JLR EBITDA margins. But I think Ashok Leyland probably saw its bottom at around 100, 105. I don't know whether it will hit a new high immediately, but the stock which continues to worry investors is really Tata Motors from that space.
All right.
Oh, absolutely. Well, Uden, would have loved to chat with you a goodish bit, but today is a packed day with a lot of guests joining us because there's so much of data to handle. Thank you very much indeed for joining us today. Look forward to your next appearance on the channel. Well, the markets have settled actually in flat terrain now. After the first 5 minutes of hyperactivity, it's flat on the Nifty, up 7 points. The Sensex is up 50, which is actually 0.15, and the Nifty Bank is down 0.25%. Clearly, market now coming to terms with the reality in terms of construction bans or rate hikes or a GDP number, which if you dig further, is not as bright as 8.2. And I don't know why stocks like Jayaprakash Power should be, higher. The news break that we announced that Prayagraj Power has been bought clearly is at a haircut that the lenders have taken. And we know now very well that once lenders take a haircut, there is no equity value. But these stocks continue to trade. It's a little scary. So the other kinds of stocks also that are moving up, people need to really watch out. With that, let's invite our market master for the morning, Neelkanth Mishra, Managing Director and India Equity Strategist of Credit Suisse, joins us. Good morning, Neelkanth. I read both your tax note as well as your GDP note. But for the benefit of viewers, sir, you're not terribly impressed by the 8.2% GDP number?
No, it is a very strong sign. This is what we wrote as well, that the disruptions are now firmly behind us. But the number itself shouldn't be, we shouldn't take that as a very strong indicator of growth. And this is something that we said when we analyzed the first quarter, that is the June quarter results for companies as well, that there was a very weak base. So if you remember, the period running up to the GST, the start of GST, there was significant inventory reduction in the economy, and therefore manufacturing, if you combine mining, manufacturing and construction, that is, so the industrial growth was only 0.1% in the June quarter last year. So the fact that it grew at 10.3% this year is therefore not surprising. On a two-year CAGR basis, the growth is actually quite average, I would say, on the industrial side, below average. On overall GDP, what is quite remarkable is that in the last five quarters, where we have seen first disruption and then a stronger growth on that disrupted base, the two-year CAGR is between 6.8 to 7%. It's almost like a flat line. So trend growth is continuing. If you remember, our 25-year CAGR is also 7%. So we are very much at trend growth. We are definitely not overheating from a CPI perspective. But what worries me quite a bit is that even at this growth, we are now running a balance of payment deficit. And therefore, even this growth appears unsustainable and has to slow down.
Nilkant, good morning. There's a bit of a dichotomy here, right? There is this growth issue, crude at close to 80, rupee at where it is. Still, the market's at new all-time high and, in fact, keeps making new highs. Your thoughts on whether, we are perhaps creating some risks here?
Not really. See, we have to understand that the economy and the market have very different constituents. So as we've often said, more than half the revenues in the Nifty and the BSE 100 are not denominated in rupees. In fact, if the USD-INR assumptions for the overall market move from, say, 64, that may have been about 6-7 months back, to, say, 71 or, say, 72-73 going forward, that by itself could actually drive Nifty EPS higher by 8-10%. So, there are refiners, there are metal companies, of course, there are IT companies, there are other companies with foreign businesses and assets. And therefore, the weakness of the rupee, and in fact, we've done a quite detailed analysis on this. So other than the fact that around rupee weakness, some foreign investors may try to preempt it and sell out and hope that they'll come in when the rupee has weakened to prevent the losses from rupee depreciation. Once you ignore that aspect, actually a year from a very meaningful rupee fall, the Nifty is generally meaningfully higher. So I don't think the external balance by itself is something that, or rather the rupee itself should be a concern on overall Nifty. For the foreign investors as well, given that other emerging markets have actually had much weaker currencies, this is not necessarily a bad market to persist with. In terms of the balance of payment deficit, though, that's something that worries me. It's almost like, a household that is consuming 130 rupees but has income of only 100 rupees, which is a 30 rupees of current account deficit. And now, even foreign lending is not available. That is, foreign capital is not available, which is that foreign capital inflows are short of 30 rupees. And therefore, say, well, they're only 20 rupees, and therefore you have to cut consumption by 10 rupees, and which is the process that now has started. I think as the rupee weakens and as it translates into, say, higher prices of autos, higher prices of consumer staples, you will see demand starting to slow down. We have started to see some signs of that. It is still distorted by seasonality of festivals and some other factors. But I think as that correction starts to happen, you may see that some of the more overvalued stocks, especially in sectors where the consumption growth will slow, may actually get negatively impacted. But overall, Nifty, I don't see a concern.
Okay, so consumption stocks could perhaps see a slowdown. Neelkanth, hi, good morning. What are the what is your analysis suggesting in terms of lead indicators? Because what we hear from companies is that construction activity has picked up, infrastructure projects are looking, you know, execution has picked up compared to what we've seen before. Now, the commercial vehicle sales indicate that even the tipper segment is doing very well, you know, directly related to construction activity. What is your own analysis suggesting?
Yeah, so construction is a sector that we've been positive on for almost 2 years now. We think that there is a lot of government money going in there, especially on the road side. We have seen some remarkable pace of activity. I mean, it was surprising to us how rapidly the Mumbai-Nagpur, that Prosperity Corridor Expressway got ordered out and construction started. And there is more than 2 trillion rupees of projects happening in Mumbai itself. There are 15 plus cities doing metro rail. A lot of this is actually extra, has extra budgetary funding. So it is not necessarily state and central government budgets where the spending growth is not that meaningful. So clearly there is, and you know, the Mumbai Baroda Expressway. So there's a lot of work that has been kicked off, and therefore it's not surprising. There are very positive construction companies. The challenge, of course, is that, you know, on the consumption side, so when you're looking at overall GDP growth, that is where our worry should be, that, and especially because of the valuations that we see in some of those sectors.
Okay, by the way, those are Bajaj Auto's numbers and they're looking very good, much better than street estimates for sure. The Nomura estimate was 4.16 lakhs. It's come in at 4.37 lakhs, which is a 30% growth. It's the highest ever monthly sales that the company has posted. And this, look at that graph. For many months now, they've been stuck in that range of, you know, 4 lakh to 4.15 lakhs. Now it's suddenly gone above that. The big kicker, really, if you look at it, the domestic sales this month have come in at about 2.38, I think. Okay. Domestic sales are 2.55, which is a 27% growth that you're seeing in domestic sales. This compares to 2.37 last month. So there's a good pickup that you're seeing in the domestic sales. And exports also, the clip is very strong in exports. 35% growth in exports at 1.81 lakh units. That compares to 1.62 in July and 1.69 in June. So both domestic and exports are firing.
The export
on
number
cylinders
is what the market very would like more, because, you know, for Bajaj Auto, that is where the key issue is. And for domestic, you know, you could have said, but that because of insurance norm, there was that perhaps extra fillip. But the export number really is something that I think the street would like. Last quarter's numbers, you saw that big derating in Bajaj Auto. Yeah.
Yes, in fact, you know, when Rajiv Bajaj spoke to us in July last month, he had told us that from October onwards, the run rate will pick up to 4.5 lakh units. So we're getting to that. I mean, one would have wondered, from 4 lakh, how would you just jump to 4.5 lakh?
But there is clearly
a steady pickup that you're seeing.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, well, to come back to you, Neelkanth, you know, I remember your previous note where you said that the best growth is behind us. So, you know, what are you looking at? The rupee depreciation has a positive impact on the Nifty, as you pointed out, and on many Nifty company earnings. So how are you looking at the earnings in FY19 and 20 now with the renewed parameters?
So the consensus numbers for FY19 are at about 31, the last I saw, and FY20 were about 24. So the FY20 over FY18 growth is about 57%. So it looks quite high. But then you have to understand that FY18 saw very large provisions made by banks, and therefore the earnings at a headline level were sort of subdued. They were actually negative 4-5%. So once you adjust for that, I think these numbers are quite achievable. There are segments, as we've discussed, where I think growth will slow. And in particular on that release, you know, the concurrent indicators actually have been very strong. In fact, if you see corporate commentary, even after the first quarter results, the commentary is very positive. So I don't think there's anything wrong with what is happening right now.
Okay.
What we have to worry about, and that is what, as market participants, we have to worry about, is what happens going forward.
Fair point. Neelkanth, as a house, Credit Suisse got that bottom on metal stocks, bang on. What's the call now? We, you know, where are we in terms of cycle? Because if you look at stock prices, while they've moved up from the recent lows, they're still way off their highs.
Absolutely. So, so we are in the midst of very significant global risk aversion. So, our Credit Suisse Global Risk Appetite Index is still in panic territory. It doesn't look like it when you look at the Indian market, but if you look at how global asset classes are trading, there is significant risk aversion. There is the equity-only risk appetite is actually at minus 7. So, you know, this is the lowest, I would say, in 15 years. So there is, I think, a lack of certainty around all the issues around the trade war. I mean, what will happen with U.S. fisc boosting up yields and forcing the Fed to raise rates, and therefore creating more pressure on emerging markets, which were heavily benefiting from the inflows because of the, you know, zero interest rate policy and the QE policies of the Fed over the past 7-8 years. As the reversal happens, how badly will growth slow down? Will there be a crisis? What's happening in China? I mean, is Chinese growth going to revive well? There is a meaningful amount of uncertainty there, and therefore, I think metals is a sector which is very greatly determined by what's happening and the expectations around China. Our own view is that there was a growth dip, and since then, there is also a revival. Last month's data was actually somewhat encouraging. And as the policy starts to support growth again, that some of those fears of a very sharp slowdown will abate. And so we have seen the stocks bounce back a bit. What is also happening is that as the evidence of undersupply, especially in sectors like steel, is now becoming stronger. So now we are in the 16th, 17th month of very elevated spreads between steel prices and iron ore and coking coal prices. So that is the profitability on this steel companies operate. And that has been so strong, and yet there has not been enough of a supply response outside of China. And which suggests that this number needs to rise higher. I mean, there are some steel stocks, some leading steel stocks in India, mm-hmm. which on current profitability are at 20% free cash flow yield. So generally, as the profitability improves, the P multiple, the EV/EBITDA multiples correct. So that correction is also happening. So we are also cutting down our target EV/EBITDA multiples. But the profit improvement, the cash flow generation is still tremendous. And so as the comfort comes around, I think these stocks would still do well. Okay. They're also rupee beneficiaries.
Of course, yes, in a big way.
A weaker rupee beneficiary.
Yes, sir. Would have loved to ask you a lot more, Neelkant, but we have another guest waiting by. Thank you very much indeed. For joining us and putting those fears on the table, the current account deficit and probably even fiscal deficit fears. Let's see whether the bullishness is able to overwhelm these deficit fears as well. Thanks, Neelkant. With that, let's invite our first big corporate into the show. We have with us Sanjeev Bajaj, Managing Director of Bajaj FinServ. Good morning, Sanjeev. Thank you very much for joining us. Well, there is so much to ask you, but first, the immediate issue, this increase in duration of third-party motor policy, the new rules that have come in. Do you think this is going to materially impact demand? Because that will mean some upfront payment.
Well, you know, it's not an issue of materially impacting demand, Lata, because this is mandatory, right? So as far as third-party policies are concerned, whether cars or two-wheelers, this is mandatory. So the business is going to be underwritten anyway. What's likely to happen is you will see companies scrambling to get access to motor dealers, because for new cars, when you're going to write a three-year policy for cars or a five-year policy for two-wheelers, that's normally going to happen out of the showroom. So you will see a scramble to get access. And a number of the large players, including us, already have this access, these tie-ups. So we have to make sure that we get our business going right away. And in our case, it started from the 1st of September. We have our products in place, and we've already started underwriting these policies. We have to observe to see that other than the first few months where something like this needs to settle down, whether it brings down what we call as the OD insurance, that is insuring your own vehicle, because as a customer, if you're going to be paying 3 and 5 year insurance on the third party side, do some of them stop covering for themselves? And I think that will be a wrong thing to do, but just from point of view of keeping the pocket light, we have to see if that is likely to happen. But otherwise, I think we'll wait and watch a few months. Another important thing is that today, motor insurance, we know, is not only the single largest line, but for example, other than insurance getting written out of motor dealers, it's also sold by agents, and the agency network, which employs individuals, is one of the largest in the country. We have to see how they get affected, and they need to be reinforced as well, which we've started doing.
Okay. Sanjeev, hi, good morning. So on an average, what kind of additional premiums do you see, if at all, for the industry and for yourself over the next few years? I mean, I was just going through a CLSA note where they say that they see a potential of $1.5 to $2 billion of additional premium by FY21, which is an upside of around 5 to 6%. Is this some kind of realistic assumption?
I've not done the calculations yet fully, but there are three different factors to consider. One, of course, upfront you're writing a 3 year and a 5 year policy. To that extent, you are writing more premium upfront in the first year. But keep in mind that for private cars, which is one of the largest segments over here, even till now, 95% of cars were getting covered under insurance anyway. So it's only going to be incremental for them. But commercial vehicles and two-wheelers will make a big difference. Now, part of what we are writing, we would have written in future years. But part of it could be additional business coming, because we know, especially two-wheelers, people after 3-4 years, many of them, especially in semi-urban and rural India, don't go and renew their policies. So there is going to be an incremental additional, I would say, revenue that's going to be generated. On the other hand, does discounting go up? Because companies, especially the smaller insurance companies, as I said, will scramble to get access to dealerships. Do they drop pricing? And if they do, then how much does that impact revenue? We have to wait and watch. I believe that you will see some boost to revenue, but it may not necessarily be the whole amount.
Okay. Sanjeev, now let me shift focus to another topic altogether. The Reserve Bank has mentioned in its annual report, they didn't give a time to say that they will bring NBFCs also under their February 12th circular, which means reporting one-day default and then participating in the restructuring along with the banks, and basically tighter monitoring. Now, if that happens, do you think there will be one belch of NPAs or something like that? How does life change?
It will again depend from NBFC to NBFC. So we've seen these guidelines when it is applied to banks over the last couple of years. There are some good quality private sector banks that have not seen much bump up in NPAs, because they've been prudent about their lending and they've been provisioning in a more conservative manner. And there were others that didn't do that. The same is true for NBFCs also. I think what's a lot more important here, Lata, to notice is over the last 5 years, if you see incremental credit that's going to SME, that's going to banks, is going a lot more from NBFCs than from banks. So that's one important thing to notice. The second is that while there may be some 10, 15,000 NBFC licenses around the country, there are really a handful of NBFCs today that are competing with banks. These are NBFCs with AUMs of, let's say, over 10,000 crores or 20,000 crores. And these are the ones that RBI is tightening its monitoring on. I think that makes a lot of sense. But you can't do it only one way. For example, the same NBFCs then need the kind of additional support that RBI gives banks, which are not available to these NBFCs. I think it's about time for RBI to recognize that the top 20, 30, 40 NBFCs, and one can, as I said, do a cutoff by size, are playing a very significant role in the banking system. And while they need tighter monitoring around their performance and reporting, they also need a different set of support and additional benefits which are available to banks, but which are not available to other NBFCs. So this is a separate class of NBFCs, which I believe RBI needs to put together.
Now, what exactly are you asking for in terms of RBI support? I mean, you all also have a lot of advantages. You don't have CRR, you don't have SLR, you don't have priority sector. So one always thought that, okay, you didn't have 4% current and savings account advantage, but you also don't have a lot of the disadvantages.
So, you know, you could balance the fact that we don't have CASA with the priority sector lending, obligations, right? So I would say put that on the side. That's something that they could keep with banks. I can understand that. But today when we are providing, so if we provide an excess to banks based on what they provide, they can get tax benefits for that. NBFCs don't. In terms of tight liquidity, as we know, RBI has a window open for banks. NBFCs don't have such access. Look at what happened with demonetization last time. Banks were allowed to collect cash. NBFCs were not. I mean, many microfinance companies actually went under because the largest amount of cash collections was happening by NBFCs and microfinance companies, not necessarily banks. Some of these differences is what needs to be removed. Just to make sure, not only to make sure it's a level playing field, but to benefit for the average consumer to benefit from this new access that NBFCs have started providing over the last 5, 7, 8 years.
Okay. What about, you know, we are noticing this month that a lot of the auto sales, the passenger vehicles, the two-wheelers have been impacted because of the unfortunate situation in Kerala. From an insurance industry standpoint, what would the impact of the Kerala floods be? I mean, what would your own exposure be there? And, you know, any kind of damage on your combined ratio?
Clearly, insurance industry as a whole has a significant exposure to Kerala like it would have in any other state. Now, you have to keep in mind that these this kind of a flood comes under national CAT exposure. So there is cover that the industry has for this as well on reinsurance. In our case, after the water started receding after the first 8-9 days, we had a full team already in place. With a number of people coming from outside of Kerala to support in early claims. So we've started that process like what we had done in JNK in earlier years as well. It will take us, my assumption is another 4 to 6 weeks to get an overall assessment of what the damages are. Our exposure to motor insurance in Kerala is not much. So we won't get hit over there much, but it is on the SME side. And as you know, the waters are receding, people are going back into their warehouses, into their factories, they're surveying damages. They will come back to us for their claims. A number is something that will appear in the next 4 to 6 weeks as we get a better sense of it. But a large part of that is reinsured. So I don't expect a very significant hit on the bottom line. Combined ratio based on the number would go up a little bit for sure. But nothing very significant.
Okay. So net-net, this new national insurance norm, is it a positive because you will make more upfront money? Is it a mild negative because there may be some deterrence to buying vehicles altogether or postponing purchase? Net-net, what is the impact?
Net-net, Lata, we'll have to wait and watch. Overall, in terms of insurance, it will be positive because I don't think people will postpone buying by much. This is not something which is likely to go. It's based on a Supreme Court decision. So that doesn't worry me. What we have to wait and watch is what it does to pricing. Do the discounts take away part of the growth? And more importantly, the different channels of growth. As I said, we are worried about the agency channel because 70-80% of the business does come from motor. Not only for us, for the industry. And if this gets taken over by dealers, by natural thing that you buy the new car from the dealer, then we have to see how to reinforce the agency channel. So it will be more about the kind of effort to be done to keep these channels viable going forward. Its actual impact on pricing, I think give or take 3 to 4 months, we will have a much better sense.
Okay, I want to ask you one question on this. The pace of growth at Bajaj Finance, I mean, last year's 4,761 crores is now 840 crore in the first quarter. I mean, this is a huge growth. What is your average growth, say, for the next 2-3 years that you can, confidently speak of? both in terms of loan growth as well as in terms of your own net income?
Lata, clearly first quarter has been an exceptional growth. As we talked about the last 2 years, we had slowed down our exposure to SME lending, where we lend against property, the LAP loans that we do, because we were seeing the economy slowing down. As I mentioned, from Q3 of last year, we started seeing this picking up. So, for example, where we had two flat years, or actually a fall actually in our LAP portfolio the last 2 years, that's grown 10% this year in the first 5 months. And these are longer term loans, so they have a positive impact as well. We've also seen strong growth in the digital part of the business. So we're doing almost 500,000 accounts in phones and handheld devices. If I were to see across e-commerce platforms last month, we've done 175,000 loans just on that. So keep in mind that across all consumer space, we are now present with our EMI card, with our MobiQuick wallet. We have 3 million active customers now on our MobiQuick wallet. Each of these are providing the tailwinds required for growth. But if you ask me what's a steady growth next 2 to 3 years, as you know, we've built our model for our AUM to grow at 25% year on year and our profits to grow around 20-25%. That's where I see it. Clearly right now we've got very strong tailwinds.